We've all been there. You're having a somewhat normal day, and then you find yourself suddenly racked by an inexplicable and unignorable pain. Maybe it's a headache that seems to have come out of nowhere, or a sensation of soreness that just won't leave you alone. So you head to the medicine cabinet or down to your local pharmacy to grab yourself something to reduce those uncomfortable symptoms as quickly as you can. Your best option? Well, in most cases, that would be painkillers. Over-the-counter medicines like these are some of the most common and affordable treatments for alleviating various forms of acute or chronic pain. But there's such a variety of painkillers out there, how are you to tell which is actually right for your current ailments? Which types of painkillers are the safest? And which ones can lead to potential danger if not taken correctly? Most importantly of all, what do painkillers actually do to your body in order to reduce or treat pain? Let's start with arguably the most widely used over-the-counter painkiller, paracetamol. Also known as acetaminophen in the US, it's commonly taken to alleviate headaches or relieve mild to moderate pain. Paracetamol can also lower a raised temperature, which makes it handy for tackling a fever that might come as the result of a cold. It achieves this by blocking the chemical messengers that travel from the body to the brain in order to alert the brain of the presence of painful sensations. When it comes to lowering temperatures, paracetamol does much of the same thing. It affects these chemical messengers in the area of the human brain that's responsible for regulating body temperature. Paracetamol is usually taken in the form of pills or capsules. However, it's also the key ingredient in many brands of over-the-counter combination painkillers or cold and flu medicines. It's because of the presence of the paracetamol in other remedies that being aware of how much you are taking is crucial. It's also possible to take too much and cause yourself potential harm, or even death. Usually, an average person can take paracetamol without issue. However, doctors and pharmacists say you should avoid the painkiller if you're pregnant, currently taking other medicine prescribed to them by their doctor, experiencing an issue with the way their liver is functioning, or if you're just outright allergic to it. For most adults, the recommended dosage is 500 milligrams taken every 4 to 6 hours, but never exceeding the maximum of 4 grams within a single day. When taking paracetamol, it's important to leave at least 4 hours between each dose and to not take more than 4 in the space of 24 hours. This is where taking too much can potentially become lethal, as too much can cause damage to a person's liver. Paracetamol poisoning occurs not directly due to the painkiller itself, but one of its metabolites, the small molecules produced by metabolism, known as N-acetyl-p-benzoquinoneamine. This can directly damage the cells within the liver. The side effects of a paracetamol overdose can include tiredness, abdominal pain, and nausea, and can set in within a day of taking the overdose. This is followed by an absence of any noticeable symptoms, then by yellowish skin, blood clotting, and confusion as a result of liver failure. Kidney failure, pancreatitis, and low blood sugar can also occur as a result of paracetamol poisoning. Without medical treatment, the toxicity caused by paracetamol overdose normally occurs within 4 days to over 2 weeks later. While it's often fatal, if you're treated, you will survive, albeit in a great deal of pain after a couple of weeks. In the United States alone, there are over 100,000 cases of paracetamol poisoning per year. In the UK, it's the medication responsible for the highest numbers of overdoses, given how readily available it is in most stores and pharmacies. However, the reason it's so readily available is that paracetamol is relatively safe for most people to consume for pain relief without suffering any potential side effects or risks of danger if taken in the recommended dosages. Often, the largest influencing factor on what type of painkillers a person needs comes down to the type of pain they're experiencing. Ibuprofen is another similarly widely available type of painkiller, much like paracetamol. However, unlike paracetamol, it has different uses. Specifically, it's more appropriate for different types of pain. For example, aches and pains like back pain, toothaches, period pains, and symptoms related to colds and flu are normally better treated by ibuprofen than paracetamol. It can also help to treat inflammation, sprains, and strains, as well as pain brought on by arthritis. Much like the aforementioned everyday painkiller, ibuprofen is typically found in the forms of pills or capsules, but there are versions that come in the form of granules that can be dissolved in water and swallowed. Ibuprofen-based gels and sprays that can be absorbed through direct contact with the skin also exist. Also similar to paracetamol, ibuprofen is often found in products that combine it with other painkillers and is a common ingredient in cold and flu medicine. The way ibuprofen actually works is by reducing the hormones in the body that are responsible for causing pain and triggering swelling. It focuses on one of the key chemical pathways of the body that causes pain and reduces the body's ability to make what's known as prostaglandins. These are the specific chemical released by the body that triggers pain inflammation, and fevers. With a reduced amount of prostaglandins in the body, these uncomfortable symptoms are reduced. When taking ibuprofen orally, this can normally take around 20 to 30 minutes to take effect. Using a product that requires ibuprofen to be absorbed by the skin takes a lot longer, usually within a couple of days. Ibuprofen is typically used for short-lived pain triggered by inflammation, such as period pain, toothache, or back pain, and the maximum dosage is around 600 milligrams, or two standard 100 milligram pills taken orally three times a day. If someone's suffering from a more consistent, recurring pain, then their doctor might prescribe them slow-release ibuprofen, which is taken fewer times throughout the day, with large gaps of around 10 to 12 hours between each dose. It's recommended that ibuprofen, when in capsule, granule, or liquid form, should be taken alongside food or drink to reduce the possibility of the painkillers disrupting the stomach. Most doctors will tell you not to take it on an empty stomach. There are a number of other known side effects of ibuprofen too, and this can affect more than 1 in every 100 people. It can occasionally trigger temporary headaches, and it's advised that you shouldn't use other medicines to alleviate these headaches should they occur. Ibuprofen does not mix well with some other medicines, especially in any of its orally taken forms. If ibuprofen makes a person feel dizzy, then it's recommended they avoid coffee, cigarettes, and alcohol, and instead lie down. Ibuprofen can also cause nausea in some people, in which they need to stick to simple meals and avoid rich or spicy foods. Being sick, experiencing gas, or suffering indigestion are also known to be caused by ingesting ibuprofen. If any of these side effects persist, a person should contact their doctor and avoid taking any other medicines to treat the side effects. When applied to the skin, ibuprofen is less likely to have an effect on any other medications present in the person's system, but when taken orally, it can. This is why it's worth, for the sake of safety, to mention to a doctor any other medication you may be taking before you start taking ibuprofen. There's also not a lot of evidence to suggest that it's safe to take any herbal remedies or supplements alongside ibuprofen, as these are not tested in the same way as pharmaceuticals. However, ibuprofen can be taken safely alongside some other painkillers, like paracetamol or codeine. However, it should not be taken with others from the same group, such as aspirin. Both ibuprofen and aspirin belong to a particular family of painkillers known as NSAIDs. This stands for non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, and if taken together, too many NSAIDs in a person's system can cause an increased risk of developing side effects. Speaking of aspirin, this is highly similar to ibuprofen in a lot of ways. Both are NSAIDs and both are everyday painkillers used to treat similar types of pain caused by inflammation as well as cold and flu symptoms. And much like its fellow NSAID, aspirin often is found as an ingredient in cold and flu medicine. You'll find aspirin as an ingredient in medicines like Anadine, Alka-Seltzer, and Beekham's powders. Aspirin mainly comes in pill form or as suppositories, which are, well, we probably can't say on YouTube, but those are pills that go in the other end from the mouth. Aspirin gel also exists, and it can be used on mouth ulcers and cold sores. Where these particular painkillers start to differ from ibuprofen is in how aspirin is typically prescribed and to whom, as it's not suitable for everyone, and as well as how quickly it takes effect. Spoiler alert, it's a lot faster than ibuprofen. While most types of aspirin can be purchased from pharmacies and supermarkets, aspirin is only suitable for people over the age of 16. There's a potential link between aspirin and Reye's syndrome in children, a condition that causes severe damage to the liver and the brain. As a result, aspirin shouldn't be given to a child unless prescribed by a doctor. Those also experiencing symptoms of high blood pressure, indigestion, liver or kidney problems, or gout should also first consult a doctor before taking aspirin. Normally, aspirin is found in pills of 300 milligrams, and 1 to 2 should be taken at the same rate as paracetamol, which is to say every 4 to 6 hours. A person should not exceed more than 12 doses over the course of a single day. There also exist low-dose forms of aspirin that can be prescribed to those who have suffered heart attacks or strokes and to some pregnant people. However, this is different from taking aspirin for pain relief and should only be done when recommended by a medical professional. Aspirin works by blocking a particular enzyme in the body, known as cyclooxygenase. This enzyme is responsible for producing a range of hormones known as prostanoids. These are present within our blood and regulate the activity of blood platelets, the cells that allow blood to flow through the narrow vessels of the lungs. These prostanoids also affect inflamed areas of the body, like sprains or damaged joints. So by reducing the amount of cyclooxygenase, aspirin prevents the blood platelets from sticking together, thus reducing pain and inflammation. However, because of the effect it has on the blood, one of the most common side effects of taking aspirin is the increased risk of bleeding. Without the platelets sticking together, patients may occasionally experience minor or severe bleeds, commonly within the stomach or intestines. Severe bleeds can also occur in the brain, which can lead to a stroke. While a rare outcome, this is a potentially very dangerous side effect of taking aspirin. As a result, doctors will not prescribe it to just anyone, especially those known to have a sensitivity to the painkiller, for their own safety. In those with asthma, aspirin can also trigger asthmatic attacks. Generally, it's not recommended that anyone who is otherwise healthy takes over-the-counter aspirin unless told to by a doctor to treat a specific pain. Additionally, those taking other medications should seek professional advice before taking aspirin, as taking it alongside medicines that are intended to prevent blood clots can also lead to bleeding problems. There are non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs other than aspirin and ibuprofen, the third belonging to the NSAID family being naproxen. This painkiller specifically targets pain in the joints and muscles, and as such, it's used to treat rheumatoid arthritis, caused by the swelling of the lining of the joints, osteoarthritis, arthritis caused by a breakdown of the lining of the joints, as well as gout, period pains, and muscular or bone disorders, including back pain, sprains, and strains. Naproxen is typically only available by obtaining a prescription, either as pills or in a liquid form. Much like the other aforementioned NSAIDs, naproxen works by blocking certain enzymes, in this case, cyclooxygenase. This prevents a process called prostaglandin synthesis, those same chemicals that are reduced by aspirin. Prostaglandins elevate the body's temperature and make nerve endings more sensitive to pain transmission, so naproxen seeks to reduce the pain by blocking the enzymes relating to it. While it's considered to be effective at alleviating short-term pain, naproxen comes with the same risks as other NSAIDs, in that it can have adverse effects on the stomach, as well as potentially increasing bleeding tendency. It can interfere with other forms of medication and may even increase the risk of a stroke or heart attack, so should only be taken under the advice of medical professionals. That brings us to opioids. And don't worry, that's not the sound of the police on their way. The word opioids or opiates does bear some relation to opium, which is the plant that certain narcotics like heroin are derived from. The difference is that for one, an opiate is naturally occurring while an opioid has synthetic elements to it. For another, there do exist weak opioids that won't land you in trouble with the law, and some of those are even used as painkillers. A few common examples of so-called weak opioids include codeine and dihydrocodeine. While they might commonly be described as being weak, these opioids can be highly effective when it comes to treating more severe pain. However, they come with their own share of potentially adverse effects, including risk of dependency and addiction, and as a result, should be handled with care. There also exist stronger opioids, including morphine. However, those are rarely made available to the public and are usually only administered to patients in a hospital rather than being prescribed by a doctor. One of the aforementioned weaker opioids, codeine, is perhaps the most well-known of this particular painkiller family. It's often combined with paracetamol in pills known as cocodamol. Typically, codeine is used to treat ongoing pain after other options like paracetamol, ibuprofen, aspirin, and other NSAIDs have proven ineffective. In particular, codeine can be prescribed after a patient has suffered an injury or following a surgical procedure, as well as given to those suffering from diarrhea. However, rather than blocking specific enzymes like NSAIDs do, codeine and other opioids like it will instead affect a person's central nervous system and brain. They block the pain signals sent from the brain to the rest of the body, and this can often have a calming effect, reducing the natural stress that the brain goes through in response to an injury. Dosages of codeine are often considerably lower than those of other painkillers like aspirin or paracetamol, and it's usually found in pills of only 15, 30, or 60 milligrams. The standard dosage for adults is 1 or 2 30 milligram pills every 4 hours, with no more than 8 being consumed in one day. Much like the others we've mentioned, codeine comes with potential side effects, and the higher the dose, the more likely someone's to experience it. This can include feeling constipated, sick or nauseous, sleepy or dizzy, as well as experiencing confusion and headaches. However, there's also the risk of becoming addicted to codeine, a danger it shares with its fellow opioids. Most doctors, when prescribing codeine, will be able to offer advice on how to overcome this outcome, but signs of an addiction can include feelings of agitation if someone misses a dose. It'd probably be irresponsible to discuss opioids without briefly touching on some of the wider effects that the proliferation of opioids has had in the United States specifically. Improper prescription of opioids, often after major surgical treatments, have resulted in a national opioid crisis, where thousands of addicts, particularly in rural areas, have been forced into inescapable spirals of addiction that often lead to overdose. Globally, over 100,000 people die of opioid overdose every year, with an increasing number of these being due to fentanyl, an extremely potent synthetic opioid. In 2019, opioid overdose has been declared responsible for 15.8 deaths per 100,000 people in the USA. Experts suggest that one of the biggest drivers, and therefore one of the most potential valuable angles of attack against the opioid crisis, is overprescription, often driven by pharmaceutical companies. Tighter regulations on opioid prescriptions are needed in order to curb the issue. But until such regulations are passed, there are good reasons to feel a little skeptical if you find your doctor is a little too eager to prescribe the latest synthetic opioid. These are some of the most commonly available painkillers, and exactly what they do to our bodies to help us out. As we mentioned, if you find yourself experiencing any pain beyond that which an ordinary paracetamol can help with, then it's always worth consulting your doctor. They'll be able to advise you best on what painkillers are right for what ails you.